co-authors and co-organizers with Dr. Agárdi. Her real name is Bella. Agárdi Isabella. Welcome. This is not exactly a conference proper. It's another a workshop which we would like to close our very fruitful semester, the fall semester, and further a little bit our discussions, debates, considerations of what we call Central Europe. And I just mentioned it to our distinguished guests that this discussion has a history here, more than 25 years. When we arrived to Kőszegen, we got this beautiful building, we came to the conclusion immediately with my friends, colleagues, among them, of course, Elemér Hankis, Professor Pusztai, that this is a perfect place to talk about Europe, but even more about Central Europe. And I don't go into details because of the border region, because of Kőszeg's origins, Croatian, German, etc., etc. And ever since we have this idea, this image, it's a place where you discuss history from how to say, a third point of view. It's neither an Austrian or Czech or Slovak, but it's in between, a middle point, if you want. And it has and it had impact from all of these big centers, but it has kind of a third dimension, a third place, so to speak. As it goes, in my understanding, maybe not everyone agrees with me, it's an atypical Hungarian city. Of course, it's in Hungary. It determines Kőszeg to be a place of dialogue, of open thoughts, deeper discussions. So it happened that ever since we have a summer university where Central Europe is almost always one of the major issues. This is going to happen next year as well. But today, we should remember a very special Central European production, Central European construction, which we call the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which collapsed 100 years ago. And not following the good Hungarian traditions or East and Central European traditions to celebrate your lack of success, your collapse, your failure, we don't want to have any nostalgia here in this room, but probably try to remember to discuss the very, very positive aspects, dimensions of this cultural, social, and of course political and economic space, the very, very spacious empire, and talk about the tendencies which are still with us. In what way can we rethink or continue these positive elements of this very complex configuration, what we call Austro-Hungarian? So, of course, we talk about arts, art history. A little bit we did already introduce music the day before yesterday. We had a premiere, a concert from the Binder Trio, and rethinking of Béla Bartók, Für Kinder, for children, which was composed 110 years ago. That's just a small example. Another example that two years ago, Kunsthalle, and our colleague András Bán, he was a former deputy director of Kunsthalle Műcsarnok in Hungarian, they organized a wonderful exhibition about the arts of the monarchy, mostly this time the Kunsthalle was opened 120 years ago. And opened by Franz Josef. And so we had the pleasure to contribute to this double volume, Isabella and myself, which probably should be translated into German and English, because it's short, I'm not going to any details. It's very, very rich mostly paintings and other type of arts, how rich this world was, and whether we have lost this richness, or it's only fragmented and it's very difficult to put together the fragments, or in what way can we benefit from this very, very rich heritage. Of course, we have a couple of hours today, and this discussion will be followed by a book launch of Dr. Buzek's and Emil Bick's new books, which is called Middle Europa Revisited, after the famous 86 publication, which was called Project Middle Europa. They both thought that high time to revisit their suggestions. That was a very optimistic time. Today, we have good reasons not to be so optimistic, but we agreed before the conference started, they had a little discussion, that maybe an old illusion, a set of illusions, is collapsing, but maybe that's a good time to start to rethink, you know, what to do with our heritage, how to use it in the present and for the future. A lot of things are missing for that, but it's a good time to start a proper discussion. We have here our guests. Bella is going to introduce everyone in a minute. But we have here our students from our master course, International Studies, our colleagues from the Institute of Advanced Studies, KÖSEG. Some of our grantees are here. So it's a group of historians, economists, political scientists, sociologists, philosophers. Everyone is welcome, and let's start. Bella, the word is yours.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for coming to this workshop. Let me introduce the panelists. We have Karel von Schwarzenberg on my left, very left-hand side, and he is the former minister of foreign minister for the Republic of Czechoslovakia, the Czech Republic. I'm sorry, and he was also a candidate for the presidency in 2013. He was running as an independent candidate for the Green Party when he was running for the Foreign Affairs office, and he is the descendant of a very prestigious noble family in Bohemia. Then we have Dr. Erhard Buzek, former Vice Chancellor of Austria, and he is now, he's a recurrent visitor at IASC, and he's sitting on the board of our institute as well. He's also a visiting professor at Duke University. We have Andreas Bahn, former vice president for the Kunsthalle, and we are very delighted that he could come and be amongst us today. And he will talk about the Kunsthalle's two artistic projects today. And
he starts.
Yes, I would like to say a few words first because we thought that the apropos, the centenary of the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire should be somewhat commemorated by us as well, but as Ferenc said, it should we should start trying to think about creating a critical balance of assessing that imperial past somewhere between nostalgia and resistance. So I do think, and it's a general consensus, that the legacy of the empire and understanding that legacy still poses a challenge to us. Understanding the complexity of the social and cultural dimensions of the empire. It's a very varied, multi-ethnic nature. The kind of the richness and the complex processes of urban and rural development, which has been termed in different ways by historians. By some historians, we get an image that it was kind of semi-feudal structure where elements of modernity kind of coexisted with feudal land ownership structures and social structures, as well as structures of political dominance. But the empire produced a very interesting period, especially after the 1867 compromise, and it created a sort of political governance, which was an innovation of the time, and it also witnessed a sort of liberalism as an official ideology, which, looking back now on that, seems to be somewhat of an overambitious endeavor of the time, without any deep roots and without any long-lasting consequences, or we can actually debate the continuities of this political legacy. And after the economic crisis of 1873, we see the empire to have been able to come out of it and produce an unprecedented economic boom and urbanization, which brought with itself an interesting process of urbanization with all of its problems as well. So different historians belonging to different groups, they always have a problem interpreting these processes. How to interpret this rapid urbanization, how to interpret the period itself, because if you look at the artistic production and the creativity of the era and you focus on culture, then you see, especially on upper middle class and bourgeois culture, then you see an incredible boom. But then if you concentrate on the working classes and on the urban working masses, then you get a radically different picture. And there have been historians who have tried to analyze the two capital centers of the empire, Vienna and Budapest, from these different perspectives. And there is the third dimension, which usually is referred to as identity crisis. So historians who look back on the era trying to analyze collective identities, then they see that urban identity or collective identity in Budapest and in Vienna was just about to get formed, and it was a less than coherent entity. We can't even put our finger on what made people belong to these urban communities, which was Vienna and which was Budapest. And when we were writing this piece with Ferenc, we were trying to put all of these different perspectives together and trying to, without the attempt to be universal, but we were trying to show snippets and facets of this complexity that was very characteristic of this period of the empire between the compromise and the collapse. And this period is very much referred to, very often referred to as the Golden Age, as so, it was a period of relative peace and of liberalism, of people who were quasi peacefully living together in these within the imperial borders, but the movement was almost somewhat unlimited. Prospects were and prospects of social mobility, despite very distinct, with a modern expression we could call it, glass ceilings. There were still it was still possible. So education was, higher education was developing in the Hungarian part of the empire very rapidly. The first university faculties were established in Budapest, in Cluj, in Debrecen, and students could actually opt for institutions in the Hungarian part of the empire for the first time. Before that, they went to Vienna or Western Europe, Paris, to study. We were also trying to analyze the role of the Jewish population and the new industrialists who were creating, they were comprising 1/4 of Budapest's inhabitants, and it was a very distinct urban culture that was created this way, through their presence in Budapest, at least. And we were trying to analyze the differences between Vienna and Budapest, and this is something that is always also open for discussion, how much Vienna was differing from Budapest as the two centers, Budapest being this kind of, having this image of being this more chaotic, more artistic urban milieu, and Vienna being the imperial, the sort of imperial center, the masculine center with all the institutions of governance of the military. I think that's it's an interesting thing to think about. And then also we can probably think about the issue of the two parliaments in the two centers and how the trialism, which was also an effort before the compromise, setting up parliament, also a parliament in Prague, how the failure of that project kind of result may have resulted the collapse or may have not. As far as the historians writing the history of this era, we also were wondering about how, looking at this era through the lens of the collapse and through the lens of the downfall, how do we see that it was absolutely necessary? Do we still, or is our vision conditioned by the collapse itself, and it conditions us to believe that the empire was inherently possessing all those traits that led to its collapse, and the First World War, and then its collapse. Because with this retrospective bias, we tend to analyze the era through the outcome of the era. So, and I would like, we wanted to encourage you and urge you to think about all of these elements. How necessary was the collapse itself? And how, because we are always priding ourselves when we are being nostalgic about the empire, how all those ethnicities could live in, could live together in peace. And then we tend to forget about the ethnic tensions. We tend to forget about all the problems that the multi-ethnic nature of the empire kind of carried with itself and did not know how to handle. So, and also when we study how upper middle classes and middle classes lived in the urban centers and what kind of artistic productions emerged in this incredibly creative era, then we tend to forget about women's movements, we tend to forget about workers' movements and all the tensions that urban life carried with itself. We tend to forget about the rise of prostitution in urban areas, and I do believe that it also deserves our attention, and to see how contradictions, social contradictions, social tensions were very gradually accumulating, and after the defeat of the First World War, it was almost impossible to create coherent, sustainable societies with a very fashionable expression. So, and in that sense, I'm very much interested, and I would also encourage us to think about the memory of the empire regarding all of these different aspects of it. So that's what I wanted to
say. This is an introduction and debate for me. I think we should ask now Andras to talk about the artistic part, and then we'll come back to the political and other. Come, Andras, please come out. And this will be in Hungarian, so the translation is provided by Attila Pók.
Gentlemen, dear colleagues, I'm Andras Bán from Budapest, Kunsthalle. My English is very poor, so Attila, help me. Thank you. Ez a nyelvi probléma egyébként, ezzel már a lényegénél vagyunk a mondandómnak. Én egy olyan generációhoz tartozom, akik úgy élték le a pályájuk nagyobb részét, hogy mindörökre a szovjet fennhatóságú birodalomba fognak élni, és ettől erős nyelvi görcsök alakultak ki sokunkba, így bennem is nem nagyon merek angolul megszólalni.
So this language problem already points out a key point in the upcoming presentation, because our presenter belongs to a generation who assumed that would live under Soviet dominance for eternity, and therefore feels certain constraints when he has to speak in a foreign language. But if I may add, even Russian was not very much.
Két kiállítást szeretnék bemutatni önöknek. Az egyiket két éve rendeztük a Műcsarnokba, az első aranykor címmel, a másik pedig a rejtett történetek, amelyik az életreform mozgalmakat és azok művészeti hatását mutatja be, ez jelenleg is megtekinthető a Műcsarnokban egészen január 20-áig.
So he is going to speak about two exhibitions in this Kunsthalle. One was called the Golden Age, the first Golden Age, and the other, which was, I think, close about a year ago, a year and a half ago, and the other one is called Hidden Stories, right? Hidden Stories, and is still to be seen.
A két kiállításnak a bemutatása megtörténhetne Úgyhogy virtuálisan végig sétálunk itt a termeken, ez van is diaanyag, de hadd válasszak ennél egy sokkal személyesebb nézőpontot, mégpedig szeretnék bemutatni három főszereplőt. Az én generációmhoz tartozó három személyiséget, akik ebben a két kiállításban kulcs szerepet játszottak. Sármány Parsons Ilona, ő a Aranykor kiállításnak a kurátora, rendezője. Németh András, aki a Rejtett Dimenziók, Rejtett Történetek kiállítás rendezője, és Szegő György, a műcsarnok igazgatója. Mind a hárman a II. Világháború után születtek, mind a hárman Magyarországon tanultak, csak Magyarországon tanultak, az iskolázottságuk ideköti őket. Mind a hárman német orientációjúak, tehát elsősorban a német kultúra iránt érzékenyek. Mind a hárman politikailag semlegesek, sőt úgy fogalmaznék, hogy inkább óvatosak, tehát nem keresik, tehát nem mondanám, hogy bármilyen értelemben forradalmárok lennének, reálpolitikusok, és szerintem az ő hármuk útja, illetve ez a produkciójuk, amiről beszélni fogok, annak a generációnak, tehát az én generációmnak a Közép-Európához, illetve annak a történeti dimenziói, az monarchiához való viszonyát nagyon pontosan jellemzi.
So our speaker decided to introduce you to these two exhibitions in an unusual way, because instead of showing you a virtual tour of the exhibits, he decided to focus on the careers, on presenting a short summary of the careers of the three curators of this exhibition, because they all belong to the same generation as he does, probably myself as well. And these three careers are quite similar and reflect one way or another the attitude of this generation toward the whole concept of Central Europe. They are similar because they got their education in communist Hungary. They were very much influenced by German culture, and as far as politics is concerned, they were always trying to define their political positions as quite neutral, careful, without affiliating themselves with any ideological platforms.
Van ennek a történetnek egy negyedik szereplője is, ez maga az épület.
Oh, sorry, I forgot to mention the names. I just forgot to mention the names. Yes, because that is Ilona Sármány Parsons, who I think still divides her life between Vienna and Budapest. Németh András, and Szegő, György Szegő, who used to be the director of...
Tehát van egy negyedik szereplő is, ez maga az épület, a műcsarnok, amelyik nagyon sűrűn bele szövődik ebbe a Közép-Európa történetbe, hiszen a millenniumra épült művészek szerveződéséből, tehát kormányzati támogatással, de alapvetően művész kezdeményezésből jött létre, fokozatosan vált a politikai, az állami reprezentáció szinterévé, ma is az, és az ezzel járó bonyodalmak és konfliktusok hát a utóbbi száz évének a sorsát erősen beárnyékolták.
So the fourth agent, the fourth character in this story is the building itself, this Kunsthalle, this art hall, which was built commemorating the 1000th anniversary of the Hungarians arriving in the Carpathian Basin, the so-called Millennium. Originally, it was a kind of a the endowment endowed by private persons, but it also got some state subsidies. And the various discussions related to the function of this building and the overall history of the building, to some extent also reflect the overall political, cultural history of the last 100 years in Hungary.
Szeretném most bemutatni Charmaine Parsons Ilona pozícióját, amikor ezt az első aranykor című kiállítást végig gondolta és megvalósításra javasolta.
So first we are going to start with the lady among the three, Ilona Charmaine Parsons. So what her platform, what her approach, what her attitude was when he made the first designs for the first exhibition, The Golden Age.
Charmaine Parsons Ilona Pesti Egyetemen végezte művészettörténet szakot, és házassága révén jutott el Londonba és Bécsbe, egyetemi professzor lett, számos könyvet publikált, ez volt az első kiállítás, amit életében csinált.
So, Ilona Charmaine Parsons, who by the way was of the same class, of the same year at the university as myself, so she was studying in Budapest, but as a result of a successful holiday in Greece, as I know, she met a British gentleman, and as a result of this successful encounter, they moved to London, and she made a career as a prestigious art historian, and became university professor, and this was, this golden age, the very first exhibition that she prepared and organized as a curator.
Amikor ő egyetemre járt, nyugodtan beszélhetek a nevében, mert egyéb folyammal fölöttem járt, tehát én is ugyanezt tanultam. Tehát amikor ő egyetemre járt, akkor létezett európai művészet, és ettől független létezett valami nem teljesen ide tartozó magyar művészet, és ebben az európai művészetben a 19. század egy abszolút lineáris szerkezetű valami volt, amelyik egy út, egy keskeny út a modernség felé. Ebből a történetből hiányzott a historizmus, hiányzott a szecesszió, sőt a szecesszió kifejezetten szitokszó volt abban az időszakban, és ebben az egész történetben a kánon problémájáról beszélünk. Az egész történetben egy nagy fordulat jóval azután következett, hogy mi elkezdtük a pályánkat.
So when she studied together with our presenter at the Faculty of Humanities of Budapest University, History of Art, then the teaching of the history of art was a little bit split between teaching the history of European art and the teaching of the history of Hungarian art, and the two were not fully integrated. As far as the teaching of European art history was concerned, it had a kind of a teleological linear approach from the beginnings to modernity, without referring to such key concepts like historicism and Jugendstil secession. And even as far as the latter is concerned, the concept of Jugendstil secession was considered to be something something reactionary, I would even say, to, you didn't mention this, but reactionary, so something very negative. It turned out to be a kind of a curse word during the time they were learning art history in Budapest University.
Amikor ezt az első aranykor kiállítást kezdeményeztem, tulajdonképpen két sarok megállapítást tett. Az egyik, hogy bár 2016-ot írtunk akkor, amikor ezt a kiállítást szerveztük, a maga műveltségével, ami nem kicsi, ő nem ismert olyan kiállítást, ami a monarchia képzőművészetével foglalkozott volna. Ez a kiállítás nem történt még meg. A másik megállapítása pedig az volt, hogy 1990 körül a közép-európai utódállamok művészetének volt egy komoly esélye, hogy valami módon bevezetést nyerjenek ebbe az európai történetbe. Erről Magyarország mindenképp lemaradt, tehát valahogy ez a visszaintegrálódás legalábbis a művészet területén nem történt meg. Tehát ez volt az 5 év kiinduló
pontja. So when Ilona Sharman Parton started preparing this exhibition, she started out from two assumptions. So the first was that in spite of being extremely well informed, she figured out that there has never been anywhere in the world a comprehensive exhibition devoted to the art of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy. The other assumption was that now in the preparation started in 2016, but she was thinking back into the aftermath of the collapse of the Soviet bloc, and she assumed that the options given by the political development might also encourage, make it possible for Hungarian art and Hungarian art history to be fully reintegrated into Europe, into the European mainstream.
Ezen megfontolásokból ő egy olyan kiállítás szervezésébe fogott bele, ami néhány nagyon erős tétel megfogalmazására vállalkozott. Ezen erős tételek ből néhányat elsorolnék. Az egyik az az, hogy a monarchia és ezen belül a magyar művészeti modernizálódás egy saját út. Tehát nem egy periféria, hanem a modernség problémája ebben a közép-európai művészetben másképp jelenik meg. A történeti, a szociális témák épp úgy a modernizálódás szolgálják, mint Párizsban a művészet autonómiájának.
When preparing this exhibition, Ilona was basing her plans on a few very strong points. The first such point was that Hungarian art and the Austro-Hungarian art of the time should not at all be considered as a periphery of West European respective development. It's not a more or less dealing with the same type of problem. It's not a peripheral, but a different way to modernity. So there is an equality in terms of modernist approaches.
A második tétel, amit megpróbált megfogalmazni, az az, hogy ez a közép-európai terület több központú volt, tehát Bécs és Budapest mellett fontos volt Prága, Krakó, Zágráb, és ezekben a központokban a művészetről való gondolkodás mind tematikusan, mind stilárisan, meglehetősen hasonlóan és egymásra hatva alakult. Erre egy erős példa volt maga a kiállítás, amelyik csak olyan művészeket állított ki ezekből az országokból, akik a műcsarnok alapítása, illetve ennek az épületnek az alapítása 1896 és 1910 között tényleg kiállítottak Budapesten.
So the other major point of her plans was that the Central European region was a multi-centered region, also from the perspective of art history, art. In addition to Vienna and Budapest, Zagreb, Prague, Krakow were also major centers of cultural life. And to translate it into the real plan of the exhibition, she decided to exhibit only the works of only those artists who during the period of 1896 and 1910 indeed really had some kind of an exhibition in Budapest.
A harmadik tétel, amit megfogalmazott, az arra vonatkozott, hogy itt az ideje, hogy ennek a korszaknak a művészeti kánonját újra gondoljuk. Ahogy ez megtörtént a 1980-as évek közepén Franciaországban, Párizsban is, amikor a Musée d'Orsay megnyitásával az addigi nagyon szűk, nagyon lineáris 19. század elképzelés helyett egy polifon művészeti felfogás vált minden erősebbé. Ugyanennek meg kellene történnie a közép-európai és azon belül, ugye itt most hangsúlyosan magyar művészetben. Az egész 19. század, illetve a 20. század eleje, tehát a modernizmus szálára Julius Meyergréfe amúgy zseniális könyvében a modernizmus szálára felfűzött 19. század, 20. század eleje művészet helyett ugyanezt a polifóniát, a különféle értékek, a különféle eszmék, a különféle stílusok együttélése, egymásra következését.
So the third major point of Ilona was that one has to rethink the decisive mainstream canon, the mainstream narrative of the history of 19th and early 20th century Central European, the Habsburg monarchy and Hungarian art, more or less along the same track as it happened in the 1980s in France, when as at a major exhibition they were also presenting the history of the art of the 19th century a much more colorful way. That means that instead of this teleological, this straightforward development towards modernity, much more the complexity, the colorfulness, the many-sidedness of this 19th century development should be pointed out.
A kejtes szervezése során nagyon sajátos nehézségekkel találta magát szembe. A társintézmények Bécsbe, Prágába, Krakkóba nem szívesen adták oda a műveiket. Ezt Ilona nem csak a pillanatnyi magyar politikai helyzetnek tulajdonította, hanem annak, hogy ha egy ilyen kiállítást Bécs kezdeményezett volna, akkor nyilván ez a monarchia gondolat talán erősebbnek tűnik, de egy pesti centrumú kezdeményezést hát nem igazán támogatólag kezeltek.
There was an unexpected difficulty that she had to encounter in preparing the exhibition, because as she was approaching the museums in Prague or Krakow, they seemed to be unwilling to lend their art pieces of art. Maybe if it had not been Budapest, which was now the center of such an exhibition, but Vienna, perhaps these other museums would have been more inclined towards cooperation with Budapest, with such a museum.
A látogatottság szempontjából ez a kiállítás nagyon sikeres volt, és létrejött ez a Ferenc által is emlegetett konferencia, illetve tanulmánykötet is, amit többek között az IX-kal közösen szerveztünk. Ezen a konferencián egy sor nagyon izgalmas, tehát a teljesség igénye nélkül egy sor nagyon izgalmas kapcsolódó téma került elő, például a zsidóság résztvétele a időszak művészetében, vagy annak a kérdése, hogy a 19. század második felének kötelező rajzoktatása a monarchiába hogyan segítette elő azt, hogy a vizuális kommunikáció jobban beépült az akkori diákság kommunikációs módjai közé.
So the exhibition was very well visited, and in connection with the exhibition a major conference was also held, which was also supported by IASK, and the conference brought up a number of interesting issues. He points out only two of them. One was the contribution of Jews, the monarchist Jewry, to the artistic creativity. The other is that in the schools of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy there were mandatory classes to learn drawing. And to what extent this mandatory teaching of drawings might have contributed to the artistic creativity of this time.
Ebben a tanulmánykötetben megjelentettünk egy szöveget, aminél aztán, hogy úgy mondjam, le is ragadtunk. Ez Német Andrásnak volt egy tanulmánya. Német András egyetemi tanár, a ELTE neveléstudományi tanszékének a vezetője, és írt egy számomra hallatlan izgalmas szöveget arról, hogy az életreform mozgalmaknak milyen szerepe volt ugyanekkor, tehát a monarchia és az azt következő egy-két évtized idején a német nyelv területen és Közép-Európában.
There was an interesting presentation and an article in this book by András Németh, university professor in Budapest. He was focusing on the role of lifestyle movement. So there was a kind of a movement to introduce a more healthy and more creative way of day-to-day life with lots of sports and exercises. And so to what extent also these lifestyle movements might have contributed to the creativity of the Erfurt Monarchy.
Elhatároztuk, hogy egy életreform kiállítással is szeretnénk foglalkozni. Ez a kiállítás tekinthető meg most. Ellentétben Sármány Parsons Ilona aranykor kiállításával, amelyik azt gondoljuk, hogy egy nagy kutatási hátterű témának egy nagyon újszerű bemutatása volt. Ez az életreform mozgalom és hatása művészetre kiállítás mögött legalábbis a magyar nyelvterületen nincsen meg az alapkutatás, nem történt meg az alapkutatás. Ettől nyilvánvalóan a kiállítás mozaikszerű, nem tud mást bemutatni, mint ennek az életmódbeli alternatíva keresésnek a mozaik szemcséit, és hát egy picit utal ugye, az aktualitására, tehát a jelenben való következményeire is.
So this life reform movement, which is the topic now of a more recent exhibition, is not based on such an extensive basic research as was the case with this Golden Age exhibition, but it has a kind of a strong topicality. It is more mosaic-like, but has a number of contemporary messages as well.
Életreform mozgalom alapvetően egy harmadik útkeresés volt, tehát sem a kapitalizmus embertelennek gondolt módjait nem fogadta el, sem a 19. század végén azért már fogalmazódó kommunista gondolattal nem szimpatizált, hanem olyan a test és lélek újfajta egymásra találásának az útjait kereste, ami a mindennapi élet minden vonatkozását, tehát a testkultúrát, a női szerepet, a pedagógiát, a családot, a étrendet, a természethez való viszonyt egyaránt érintette.
So this life reform movement was trying to take a kind of a third way, a third road type of non-political approach. So it wanted to distance itself both from the extremes of capitalism and also to distance itself from the, by the late 19th, early 20th century, already slightly emerging socialist, social democratic movement. The point of this life reform movement was that you have to structure your life along a new unity of body and soul, instead of getting involved in ideological, kind of political type of discussions, you should focus on your lifestyle. And lifestyle includes everything, how you communicate with each other, what you eat, what sports you practice. So improving yourself, your body and spirit without getting lost in politics.
Ennek a kiállításnak egy nagyon fontos tanulsága az volt, hogy mindezen gondolatok, tehát az életreform mozgalom gondolatai Magyarországon is hihetetlenül intenzíven jelen voltak, de a formái nem. Tehát nem jöttek létre például olyan, vagy nagyon kevéssé jöttek létre olyan együttélésmódok, kommunák. Legyen az egy gyümölcstermesztő kommuna, vagy egy művészeti kommuna. Azért a német nyelvterületen sokkal több példa van. Sokkal inkább arról van szó, vagy az történt meg, hogy az egyes személyiségekben Dienes Valéria, Körösfői Krisz Aladár, Maróti Géza, Schmidt Jenő Henri, Kodály Zoltán, Kosztolányi Dezső, ezek a életreform mozgalom során fölmerülő keresések ugye, szárba szökkentek.
There was a difference between the impact of this life reform movement in Hungary, because in Germany they got much more institutionalized. So kind of communes were set up, be it fruit growing or some handicraft community. In Hungary that was not the case. The life reform movement was not so much institutionalized, but had a great impact on the individual development, intellectual development of a great number of people. Schmidt Jenő Henrik, Körösfői Aladár, Dienes Valéria, Zoltán Kodály, the famous musician. So in the development of their own intellectual profiles and their own lifestyles, they were profiting from the impact of the life reform movement.
A kiállítás tanulsága kettős. Egyrészt nagyon fontossá vált annak a kutatása, hogy a felszíni jelenségek alatt melyek voltak azok a személyes, intellektuális kapcsolathálók, amelyeken keresztül ezen eszmék mozogtak.
So the exhibition, so we are speaking about the second exhibition, teaches us two lessons. The first lesson is that under the surface of the artistic phenomena, what kind of personal relationship, what kind of personal connections, what types of networks were moving these people.
A másik nagyon fontos tanulsága pedig az volt, hogy ennek az életreform mozgalomnak bizonyos elemei önálló életre keltek. Tehát a Magyar Mozdulatművészeti Iskola meglehetősen erőssé, majdnem hungarikummá vált. Meglehetősen szétágazó volt például a jóga jelenléte a két háború közötti gondolkodásba. Aztán az étrendbeli következmények, ugye a bicsérdizmus, tehát a zöldségevésnek a kultusza, tehát ezek mind egymástól függetlenül kicsi intézményekké váltak az életreform mozgalom teljes életet módosító komplexitás, vagy a pedagógia, tehát az új iskola, az oktatás reform mozgalma, tehát széttört elemeire, széttört intézményeire ez a mozgalom, de egészében nem tudok jelen lenni.
So the life reform movement had a more fragile impact, more diversified impact in Hungary than in some other countries. Not the complexity of the movement, but certain elements of this movement had a certain impact, like a certain dietary reform, where you were expected to focus on eating just vegetables, or movements, a kind of how the teaching of certain movements can also develop your personality. Certain fragments of the life reform movement had a very deep impact, but we cannot speak about an overall institutional implementation of the life reform movement in Hungary.
Hogy lekerekítsem azt az ívet, amit elkezdtem, tehát ugye arról kezdtem beszélni, hogy tulajdonképpen a történelmi tanulságok helyett egyetlen egy generáció, saját generációmnak a Közép-Európa gondolathoz és a történelmi előzményeihez való viszonyát hogyan látjuk. Ez a két kérdés, tehát az említett kollégák, az említett kutatók a saját személyes kutatási tapasztalataikon keresztül jutottak el oda, hogy ezzel a két kiállással, ezzel a két kiállítással valamit el kell mondjanak Közép-Európáról. Annak ellenére, hogy a hogy mondjam, közép-európainak lenni az ő fiatal korukba problémát jelentett. Azt jelentette, hogy belenyugszunk abba, ahol élünk, nem pedig az igazi európai orientáció tagjai vagyunk.
To come back to the starting point of the presentation, it was these two exhibitions were trying to express the attitudes of this generation, so those born around 1950, toward the concept of Central Europe, how this part of the world could be reintegrated in the European mainstream, because when we were, I think I could speak in plural as well, including myself, there was no option for thinking in terms of a Central European unity, because that was considered to be contrary to the mainstream ideological definition of the culture and politics of the time.
Tulajdonképpen a kiállítások, a két kiállítás fogadtatása is eléggé agályos. Mindkét kiállítás látogatottsága és sajtóvisszhangja igen magas, ugyanakkor a visszajelzések arról szólnak, hogy a két kiállítás által hordozott gondolatok nem nagyon érkeznek meg. A néző úgy megy végig ezen a két kiállításon, hogy milyen szép képek.
So there is a certain problem as far as the reception of these two exhibitions was concerned. On the one hand, there were a great number of visitors, it was a great success, but on the other hand, the messages that our presenter was just trying to point out somehow didn't get through, they didn't achieve the target audience, because the general impression was that as the visitors are walking through the exhibitions, they are very much impressed by the beauty of these pieces of art without grasping the message.
Én személy szerint, vagy személyes tapasztalatom arról szól, hogy olyan, és most csak a magyar szemszögből beszélek természetesen, olyan mértékig beletemetkezettek vagyunk a saját kibeszéletlen traumáinkba, ki nem mondott konszenzusainkba, hogy másképp fejezem be inkább. Hadd elevenítsek föl egy kádárkorbeli politikailag nagyon inkorrekt viccet, az idősebbek biztos, hogy ismerik. Ez így szól, hogy hogyan tudjuk megoldani az erdélyi problémát. Nagyon egyszerű, hívjuk be az összes cigányt katonának, küldjük rá őket Romániára, ha nyernek, az nagyszerű, de ha vesztenek, az is. Tehát én azt gondolom, hogy olyan mélyek ezek a görcsök, amelyeknek a kioldása egy-egy ilyen kulturális gesztussal majdnem lehetetlen. Még egy záró mondat. Hadd mondjam most, ami szerintem ami változott a Kádár korhoz képest mostanáig, hogy most már vicceket sem esélünk.
So our speaker was trying to find some kind of an explanation for this mixed outcome of the exhibition, that from an aesthetic point of view, it was a great success, but from the point of view of the intellectual message, it didn't go through. So probably the reason for that is that we are still a little bit too much preoccupied with our more recent traumas, with our more recent problems, without being able to distance ourselves from the stereotypes, from stereotyping traumatic approaches. And there might be some attempt to get through these problems with some sense of humor, but sometimes we succeed, sometimes we fail. Okay,
thank you.
Thank you, András. You grasped a huge terrain, and there was a bridge between arts and lifestyle reform and our traumas today. So it's a lot to discuss, but I think we should move further. And I'd like to ask Dr. Buzek to make his presentation. And then I would suggest that we have a debate at the end of everything, and after the book launch, we try to bring together the different lines. Or first,
I think.
Or? It's up to you.
You want to start?
Tutta fe gar for me who start you. You were called first.
Okay.
Well, I'll tell you why. So I called him first because I thought that you will talk more about present problems.
About whose problem?
Okay, who would be the next?
Okay, let's hurry on, because it's a huge subject. Many thanks, it was quite interesting. Maybe what I'm now presenting is a little bit of a change in the approach. First of all, I may tell you, in Austria we are celebrating on the footprints 1918 to 2018, but the content is not quite clear. I may explain you, the former state president, Heinz Fischer, did a speech for the opening. It was a huge assembly listening in the City Hall of Vienna. And I repeat what he was saying. He started with a sentence, on the 12th of November, the Republic of Austria was founded in front of the parliament. Full stop. Second sentence, on the 13th of March, Adolf Hitler was standing at the Hofburg and saying, my home country is returning it. That was it. Here you can see the whole tension of the real question. I think my criticism on this exercise, starting from 1918 to now, is that there was no description about the sources, about the origin, about the parts, what brought the current Austria together. This is very different, I think, even to your approach now, but also I was taking part in Czech Republic and in Slovakia. They are doing it in quite another direction. The whole exercise in Czech Republic is from 1848 to now. In Slovakia, quite similar. I think I was taking part at two events in Czech Republic. The one was in Kromažiš, in Kremzir, remembering here the Council of the Empire in 1849, after the whole crisis of 1848. It was a huge event of historians, with some good speeches. Another one was happening at the Charles University in Prague, also looking to more different. Why? And now I try to explain my home country, my beloved home country. We have still some difficulties about what is the origin of Austria. I think the Social Democrats especially will think Austria is existing since 1918. And what was before was other, and so on and so on, and it's quite different.
Maybe unimportant.
Unimportant, it's difficult because Viktor Adler created his movement in the time of the monarchy and by the consequences of Ringstrassen buildings so far. That's one of the difficulties. Maybe it's improving more in the direction that we are also looking to what's going on. But to give you one example, the first exhibition on the so-called Kronprinzenwerk, on the elaboration under the presidency of Crown Prince Rudolf, documenting the old monarchy and so on, happened, I think, 3 or 4 years ago for the first time. I think nobody was really looking at this. We have still some difficulties with our own history, not yet managed. It's improving, I want to be fair, but it's not really happening. On the side of the Christian Democrats or whatever you want to say, I think the have some difficulties to mention we have some roots in the time of the monarchy because sometimes they are very anxious that somebody would say you are monarchist or whatever, you are looking backwards, which is silly, by the way, because to say it quite bluntly, Austria is living out of its history. We are selling it by tourism, I think really sometimes in a very cruel way, doing it because...
more kitschy than cruel.
Right, Empress Sisi and Emperor Franz Josef being everywhere and so on and so on. That's one of the difficulties. It's a difficulty of one part of the political leaders and so on and so on, but it has to be mentioned. So far, I think looking back to these 100 years, they are trying more to move forward with all the difficulties of 1938 and so on and so on. It's very much depending, and to say it in an academic institution like here, it's the right place. It's mainly created by a part of researchers on temporary history. Mm-hmm. I think we have still a strong movement, which is not a big echo in the public, how to handle history. I give you a primitive example. There's a certain movement, we shall change the name of Heldenplatz. I think the proposal of some historians is it should be a place of the Republic, place of democracy, but never the Republic nor the democracy has ever happened at Heldenplatz. It was in other parts for sure. It's a little bit, the historians especially are fixed here on Hitler, on this balcony. So far, we are still discussing. We have to rebuild the balcony and so on and so on. I think it has to be mentioned because it's really typical for more the scientific discussion. I think not so much the public. For the common Austrians, it's not a problem to deal with the past before 1918 because it's a kind of a reality of Austria. We are living out of it. Not only by tourism, but also for sure in general, especially in the cultural way. So far, the presentation of your exhibition was very interesting for me because, and this I have to say, very critical on Austria, we are not too much looking to Budapest in this context. Yeah. I think it is only focusing maybe on the Austrian part. I don't want to say Austrian part because in Austria-Hungary, the one part was never named Austria. The title, I can show it only in German, Die im Reichsrate vertreten an Königreiche und Länder. The other part was Kingdom of Hungary. It was more simple, for sure. It was, and this is explaining also the situation, even in explaining Central Europe today. I think here you can see the roots of the different difficulties. So far, concerning how it is done in Austria, it's not yet managed, but I may say this way of limited look is shrinking in a certain way. Maybe it's depending how much science and actual history writing is moving here in the right direction. First block of my comment. Second, what about Austria? I think you have to understand that there's really something left that the explanation what means Austria was never quite clear. I think the so-called nation state in the Austrian discussion was never used in the context of Austria. I was the chair of the youth organizations in Austria a long time ago. We decided as a statue Austria is a cultural nation, but we didn't have any success on this. I think it's never clear. Nobody is saying Austria is a nation state or something like that. It's not existing because for sure, me, even by instinct, it's quite clear that we are not a real nation here. We are together. We are homeland, Heimat, and so on and so on in a certain way. those are difficulties, how Heimat was used also in the past, that has also to be mentioned. That's one of the difficulties to deal with history. In practice, I may say, the common Austrian has no difficulties with this. Contrast program. I'm involved in some European affairs. I'm with very much interest looking that it is coming up in the United Kingdom, the view to the Commonwealth, even under the auspices of Brexit. I think still the French are convinced that the Communauté Française and so on plays a very important role with all the difficulties they have. You can see it by the current event in Strasbourg, because the man who did it is coming from Algiers. So far here you can see the difficulties. I think another difficulty is our dear friend Vladimir Putin, because he's very much looking back to the Tsarist Empire, using it in the right direction, in the context also with the Orthodox Church, for sure. And the most extreme view is by Erdogan, looking back to Ottoman Empire. No? That's not happening in Austria. I think we have no movement in this direction, looking back.
Maybe the Hungarians are going to help you.
Yeah, the Hungarians, you have some difficulties with Trianon Treaty, I think.
Well,
you have a limited view of the Kingdom of Hungary. Yeah, they say.
Bit a little. Yeah.
Yeah. But a special case, let's discuss it later. So far, I think what is not really understood, and that's my version, that this development of the name Austria was coming out of Casa Austria. I think the self-explanation by Emperor Charles V, may I say in a modern way, I think the Habsburg Empire was a kind of a family enterprise with different branches. Keeping a differentiation, for sure. It was only Emperor Joseph II tried to unify it in a certain way, but he failed here totally by language and so on and so on. But in general, I think the old empire was still always very differentiated. So far, I think the European Union can learn out of it, because at the end of the empire, there were some slogans used. Indivisibilita ac inseparabilita. E pluribus unum, and so on and so on. I think a lot of words which are still in a similar way used for the European Union now in the current crisis. I think e pluribus unum, which is not really happening in fact, and it was not happening viribus unitis, for example. I think it's still mentioned that this biggest ship of the Austrian Navy was brought by itself down to the ground at the end of the First World War. Also, it's a kind of a symbol here of the development. So far, that's a difficulty, which is not really discussed, I think, here. We have no discussion about Austria as a nation state. It is, it's Austria, full stop. I think not a real problem. There is a certain background by the so-called Bundesländer, by the different states within Austria. They have even a tougher view to their own history, I think being driven sometimes in a very nostalgic way. If I'm looking, for example, to Archduke Johann in Styria, I think that plays a little bit of a role, but I think it's not really history, it's not really politically. I think it is a selling position of the different countries of themselves with a kind of differentiation. I think that's a difference to other part. I think in this sense we have some difficulties with history and no difficulties with the history also at the same time here. I think the difficulties we have is still more with the Nazi time, but also I think it's a little bit going down and not quite important. Historians are partly living out of this because they are trying to rename streets and so on and so on. I think we have a tough discussion about Lega. I think the Ringstrasse was renamed from Lega to Universitätsring because it's in front of the university, but we have still a monument of Lega here for sure existing and so on and so on. I think here you can see what the difficulties are in reality. I think that's the context of the monarchy which has to be mentioned. I'm not quite sure that it might be possible to do an exhibition in Austria with the title Austro-Hungarian Monarchy. I think monarchy, that's not really possible because we have still difficulties in perception here.
That's interesting.
It is reality on the one side, okay. We are accepting that Emperor Franz Josef is in every bigger room of the past here by painting and so on, but on the other side, I think it is not a clear relation for sure existing.
Interesting.
I think here you are stronger in a certain way of history here existing. It might existing out of this, that this Austrian part of this Im Reichsrat der Vertretener Königreiche und Länder, I think we are very much differentiated with the variety here. And here I'm jumping to Middle Europa. We had for a very long time, and I was one of the promoter of the expression Middle Europa, we had long time difficulties with our foreign ministry. Our foreign ministry, especially under Alois Mock, was really convinced the expression Middle Europa is not allowed to be used. I think for the cultural institutes of Austria, it was clearly defined it is Central Europe. Even by the difficulty that everything what is central is connected with the communist time. So for another things, we are not using central, but here it was used. The reason was coming out of the First World War, because there was a plan by the Germans built up what to do in the middle of Europe if the Germans are winning
that's
the war,
no one, yeah,
how can it be done?
Hinterland.
No, it was not hinterland. I think it was a kind of domination through the Germans. This is an ongoing debate. I had even personally with Helmut Kohl a huge debate as I was starting to speak about Middle Europa. He was inviting me for a long talk saying, Middle Europa you can only do with the Germans. I was opposing this because Germany is a little bit too big for the Middle Europa situation we have, which for sure is quite right. In a certain way the Visegrad discussion is here coming in early time without the expression Visegrad, but here you have the difficulties for sure existing, and it's still one of the difficulties here. So far, in this context, I think with our self-definition of Austria, beside the right expression, nation-state or not nation-state, we don't have any problems. I think so far, this job is done. And for sure, it's quite good. If you are doing polls, the percentage in favor of current Austria, I think, is quite a huge one. Nobody might have the idea. It's even difficult in the young generation to explain why Austria was named after the First World War Deutsch Österreich. That's always connected, I think, especially with the Nazis, which was wrong. Deutsch Österreich was always the expression for the members of the Reichsrat coming out of areas German-speaking and so on and so on, and nothing else. That's not anymore known. I may tell you the history of my institute was Danube Region and Central Europe. I think originally it was only the name Institute for the Danube Region. Who were the founders? The Sudetendeutsche Landsmannschaft. Nobody knows it anymore in Austria, but they did after 1948, after communism came up in this area, some exercises what to do with the rest of German-speaking parts on the other side of the Iron Curtain. And the real aim of the Institute was to protect these minorities. That's gone. We renamed the Institute a long time ago, Institute for Central Europe and Danube Region, for sure, and I think it fits quite more to the situation. The expression Middle Europa for a very long time was only used in two cases. There was a Mitropa Cup, in football, long time ago, and it's always mentioned if the weather predictions are done. I think speaking about the weather, then it was in Middle Europa there will be snow, rain, or whatever, and that's it. I think we did some revival to the Middle Europa discussion. It's not anymore overshadowed about this, but I think still, and here I'm jumping into actuality, I think is, we are real jumping in the situations that we have not yet managed the situation after the First World War. We are still living with the problems out of the First World War.
Exactly.
I think you can name it up. It's the Visegrad countries and the cooperation. From outside, the Visegrad countries are seen quite more coherent as they are in reality. Now, from outside, everybody is saying, it's a bloc. I think I'm too much internally involved. It's not a bloc. I think the first you Slovaks are explaining, I think let's keep out the Polish. And so on and so on. That's quite an interesting situation. There's no real discussion in a broader sense about, but that's one of the realities. But also exercises, let's enlarge the Visegrad countries by Austria and Slovenia failed also totally. We have this formula of Visegrad plus two, that's including the Austrians and the Slovenians, but it's not accepted. I think it's not accepted by the Visegrad countries because they have enough problems here for sure internally. And then you have this huge block of themes which are existing, what to do with Bosnia-Herzegovina, it's one of the not yet solved problems existing, what to do with Kosovo, which is also deep rooted in the history of the Habsburg monarchy, because I think those who were living there, the Serbs, were brought to Hungary. They are now at St. Andre, for example, and so on and so on. We have still, I think, three Serbian Orthodox churches in St. Andre, interesting enough. Yes. It's left from history, yes, just as an example here, and so on and so on. Or you have strange situations, the Croatian minority on the Hungarian side and on the Austrian side along the border, they were brought here to defend this border against the Ottoman Empire, and even before against a lot of groups fighting here. And now we have the interesting situations that the philologists of the Zagreb University are coming to Burgenland to write down how the Croatian language is here used. It's a kind of a medieval language which is mainly kept by the Catholic Church here. And so far they want to alienate the Croatian language from the Serb language. That's a real background of this exercise, which is also a little bit crazy, but for sure here it's happening. I can tell you a long list of the current problems still existing, what is Middle Europe, Central Europe, and so on, as a follow-up of the monarchy. I think these are one of the main problems. For the moment, I may say, this part of Europe is the more stable part. We have some other which are quite more on the move. If you are looking to the east, concerning Ukraine, Moldova, Belarusia, and so on, which are not really managed. And I think here we have to do more in this direction. I think it's quite an important role of the universities because they can take some leadership of discussion, but it is a request for politics happening here. And may I say, the politicians at the moment are not really looking forward. To be quite bluntly, for my feeling, and I want to be outspoken, I have the feeling we are really in the beginning of the Third World War, quite in another case. It is not a war of the First World War, not a war of the Second World War, with borders and fighting and so on and so on. We have some fights, cyber war, trade war, and so on and so on. These are the real wars for sure existing. With an interesting role of the United States, because he played a very good role in the beginning of Europe after the Second World War, or even I may say after the downfall of communism. But now for the moment, our dear friend Donald Trump is a kick in the ass of the Europeans. Hopefully they are deciding to look to themselves and to manage it that we are able to come together. I'm limited optimistic, I may say. For the moment, it's not really looking like. That's one of the positive sides of Brexit, I may say, because for the moment, they are keeping a little bit more together, but what in consequence will be, it's difficult to predict. Here I might stop and we can continue.
We'll continue. Thank you very much. And I would like to ask now Karl Schwarzenberg to continue.
Thank you so much. Could I have the microphone back? Okay. Thank you. If we discuss these things, we should first make clear what we understand under certain words. For instance, for me, Central Europe is very simply these countries or nations which, thanks God, lived like Western Europe through Reformation, Renaissance, Age of Reason, Civil Revolution, Bourgeois Revolution, and so on and so on. Eastern Europe had nothing of it. The difference between Central Europe and Western Europe is that in Western Europe, the reforms were forced on the governments from down, from the people. If we take the Glorious Revolution in Britain, if we the French Revolution, the Dutch uprisings, and it's always from down. We, but in olden times, was considered a luck. It is a luck, but as you will say, our reforms were never achieved from down. It was always the enlightened emperor. If it was Maria Theresia, Joseph II, Friedrich II of Prussia, King Maximilian in Bavaria, our revolutions were always done from up, down. And still says it is the very end. For instance, the greatest economic reforms in our part of the world, as we will all know, after 48, during the rule of the neo-absolutist government in Vienna, they enacted the greatest economic reforms in Central Europe, liberating economy. But nobody saw it before. And now again, after 89, it was Balcerowicz, Klaus, and I who did the revolution from up, never from down. So the difference is West enacted reforms by uprising from down. In the East, there is none. And we enacted only by our more or less enlightened rulers. The difficulty is that our nations accustomed to expect that a benevolent and wise ruler will again appear. It's not a safe bet, to be said. And sometimes we believe that somebody is a enlightened ruler, and he's exactly the difference. That's is an interesting development. We speak about the old empire. We should acknowledge that the old empire was not killed by the Allied powers in the First World War. As we all know, neither Paris or London, even the United States, thought from the beginning that the empire should be destroyed. Yes, we wanted to win the war, but not to destroy it. It's not even, but in Czechoslovakia, in Serbia, and other things, it was destroyed by the politicians who were in exile in state in London, Paris, that they destroyed empire. No, the Austrian Empire committed suicide, clearly suicide, because from the late 80s and beginning of 19th century, the empire wasn't able any reforms in both of its parts, neither in the area of the Holy Stephen's Crown, nor in the Reichsratsvertreter in Königliche Länder of Cisleitania. They were not able to enact the necessary political reforms. And what is called the Compromise of 67 could be only a very short-term provisional arrangement, because it established a strange system. There were two privileged nations, the Magyars and the German-speaking, then half-privileged Italians, Poles, Czechs, and Croats, and then there were nations without any rights, the Ruthenes, the Romanians, the Slovenes, and so on. That could go on for 10 years, but it carried on till the very end. And Austria was not able or willing to enact any necessary reform. And therefore, the end of it was that, as we all know, the venerable kingdom of the crown of the Holy Stephen broke up and disappeared, and the countries in the Breisgau just went each in another direction. And that was the end of the Old Empire. It makes no sense to be nostalgic, but we should learn what happened then. That is important, and sometimes when I think of the European Union, I'm afraid we are following the same way. Again, we are not able to enact reforms. And that is in such a complicated construction, as was the Old Empire, as is the European Union, a deadly illness that can kill the whole thing. And always when I think of the European Union and politicians disappointed by the election result and so on, I remember a slogan in Germany after the 68 revolution: "Stell dir vor, es ist Krieg und keiner geht hin." Imagine there's war and nobody will go. Imagine there's the European Union and nobody works on it. And that is a state which we really been in. I don't think it is reasonable to make opposition to the European Union. In a world of giants like China, States, Russia, and so on, we should stick together. But what I think the European Union should become is be elementary. I mean, we have a strange union where you fix in Brussels which is a protected piece of nature in your country, on the Balaton or wherever, or in the Alps. That's fixed in Brussels. And in Brussels is fixed if a jam you are producing, you are allowed to call it marmalade or another way. Or if the cheese you are producing can be used under the Polish, a very good cheese, smoked cheese, the Polish or the Slovak name of Oszczepok, which is a nonsense. On the other side, we don't have a common foreign policy, we don't have a common security policy, we don't have a common defense policy, and we have not a common energy policy, which is a mad system, excuse me. If you have numberless discussion about irrelevant things, and the European Union is not able to solve the relevant things, who should be interested in? Our generation, which were inspired by the unification of Europe, were full of it. They're dying out, I'm now 80. But still I remember it when the thing started with the treaties of Rome. But now we are again in a strange situation where there are a lot of politicians who bet on not good but old nationalism, which destroyed Europe already once, and we evidently we try successfully to revive this idea, which is a tragedy. And in Central Europe, we have to remember one thing. After the lost war against Prussia, 1866, it was the only time in our part of the world where the liberals were ruling, even the old empire. This period was just for 10 years, and then they were toppled. And the strange thing is that in all our nations, in Hungary, in German-speaking part, in Czech-speaking part, the liberals turned in the shortest possible way, even in one generation, in awful chauvinist and nationalist. I don't know if some, maybe these are our professional historian colleagues here, if ever somebody tried to read the utterances and article of our politicians in the end of the 19th century and before World War I. It's a crabby table. What terrible things the politicians we all know in the history of adoption, what they said in this time. The hatred, the despise, the aggressivity, and so it's incredible. And it's all in all three nations. If it were the liberals in German-speaking part turned into Altdeutsche, Großdeutsche, in Czech, in Czech country, they turned into Mladočeská strana. Sometimes I read articles of this time and speeches. It's terrible. It's the same is in Hungary. But only very late, as you know, Hungary, a movement started that you have to transform the different nations of the Crown of St. Stephen into Magyars. It was only the last third of the 19th century. Before, people could speak as well at home, Croat or Slovak or whatever, but they were part of citizens of the Crown of St. Stephen. That was all destroyed before World War I, by our, excuse me, very blind politicians then. And again, we should take the lesson. We should take more serious what our politicians sometimes say. Don't forget many of them and act what they say. And that's the greatest danger I know for the moment. You see, I remember my parents told me that in the 30s, at the beginning, nobody believed or took serious a book called Mein Kampf, written by Adolf Hitler, his main book. There's nobody, it was a bad German, but it was written, it was really a bad historical book. Nobody took it seriously. Only he realized all what he said in this book, and nobody took it in time serious. So we should be more, we shouldn't trust too much to our present politician, especially, and that starts again, that I must say, was maybe less when I was young. But now I hear again in all European nations, politicians who work and use an instrument of hatred. And I think that is the most dangerous thing we can have in Europe. And we saw it, how it destroyed the old empire, these speeches of hatred, that we should be very careful and never, never, never trust any politician who preaches hatred. It's not at all interesting against whom. For instance, good old anti-Semites preach the hatred of the Jews. Now, they became totally different. They're only preaching hatred against the other Semitic tribe, the Arabs. And that's the only difference. But hatred is still their policy. And I'm very much afraid that if we get accustomed and take as normal the speeches of hatred, we will have to repeat the awful experiences of our parents and grandparents. We had such an incredible look, all of us, that since 1945, in the 70 years, we had no war in our part of the world. Some were more lucky because they were one side of the Iron Curtain, the others were worse off in the other side of the Iron Curtain. But still we enjoyed peace. And that was a great gift, which no generation had before. And evidently we don't respect it anymore. As nobody saw the war anymore. I mean, I saw it in my time as a Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Czech Republic, when the generation who saw World War II and knew what it meant, if it was Kohl or Mitterrand or Mrs. Thatcher, left their job, and there came new politicians who never saw a real war in their own country. And I can tell you, there's an irresponsibility rises by it. those people who lived through them had some kind of responsibility. That gets lost in the meantime. And these are the developments we should take care of. Old Austrian Empire was, in my eyes, I'm a bit nostalgic, in many aspects, a wonderful thing. And you don't need to read writers like Joseph Roth or some Hungarians about this time to see the advantages of it. But our great-grandfathers admitted that in their own political parties, rising politicians who worked with hatred. And then they were astonished that everything they built up was in the shortest possible time destroyed. We are not yet as far as in the generation before World War First, but I'm afraid if it goes on, we are getting closer and closer. We get accustomed to be hated. We get accustomed again fighting against Europe. We again have the illusion that small nations, like we are all in Europe. I mean, they are very small nations. Listen, there are many towns in the world which have more inhabitants than the Hungarian Republic, than the Czech Republic, and so on. Not to speak about Croatia and so on. Towns which are bigger than us. And then we expect that we can play the game of sovereignty. It's a nonsense. It's a really nonsense. We wish to carry on some kind of European civilization. If we wish to keep on some kind of welfare, it will be less than we have till now. But to at least save something of it, then we have to recognize that we can't do it alone. None of us. It's a nonsense. And I will tell you something, what I do think is the most warning signal for us. 100 years ago, Vienna University, as we all know, was one of the centers of science in the world. Many Nobel Prize worked in it. Today, all our central universities in whole Central Europe don't have as many really important scientists as some Indian, Chinese, Japanese or American universities. All of us together. And that's only for Central Europe. And we are not able, our Central European nations, to sit together and create several centers of excellence. At least nearer to the United States or Japan. But the whole Europe has this danger. I think 3 or 4 years ago, the first time, and it didn't change then, Europe had a negative patent balance, that Europe had to buy more scientific patents from other parts of the world. That leads me to the wonderful vision that in 3 generations, Europe will be still a pleasant place, wonderful place, with beautiful nature, interesting towns, interesting literature, and other past. But it will be like Venice. We all love Venice, visiting Venice, seeing the beauties of Venice, admiring its art, but probably nobody takes serious Venice as a greater power in the Mediterranean. And we will develop a new Venice. The people will travel from the States, from China, already now, and millions of Chinese come because they enjoy the art and others. But the greatness of Europe will be tempi passati. We have to stick together. And of course, everybody is agassé.
All
Parliament and in Brussels too. People aren't saints and are sillier than they say something. But that is not an excuse to destroy what we have built up. We don't change things better if we destroy the institution that thanks God we built up since. If he destroys this too, then good night. Sleep well in the future you have.
Thank you. Thank you for this very strong and clear message. And now we turn to Erhard Buzek's and Emil Brick's new book. Ivan Babo is going to make a presentation at the book launch, and then we open up the floor for discussions and questions. Ivan. This is the book, if anyone wants to take a look.
Book.
Show it around.
No, no. Okay,
ez a tiéd. Nem beszélek.
A másik is tenyém.
Beti teszi van?
Hát csak a könyv címét szerint. Oké, okay, nyissuk meg. Azaz.
Elülök innen.
Nem, ne csak menjünk be. Keresünk meg a könyv címet. Igen, és fordítsuk ki, úgyhogy a... Igen, arra még. Ez az. Jó, köszönöm, és akkor többet megcsinálom. Jó. Thank you very much. Dear guests, Your Excellency, Mr. Buzek, Your Excellency, Mr. Minister, former Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Czech Republic, Mr. Schwarzenberg. I have to present this book, which is a very interesting one, and probably I'm the only one here who has read it.
No. You got it from me.
But you have not read it, have you?
I asked you because I read it.
You read it, so that we are too.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Then. It's a very fascinating book. Why? Because the two authors of the book are Austrians, and now we have heard that it's not very easy to be an Austrian. It's not very easy to be an Austrian in European context either. Why? Because the whole position of the authors is a typical Central European position. The authors are Central Europeans. But they are not East Central Europeans, but they are West Central Europeans, which is a different position from ours, which we usually use for interpreting the situation in Central Europe. This is my first remark, but is very, very important. The second remark is that the authors are very, very positive, and sometimes I would say quite optimistic. Optimistic in what sense? In a sense that the European Union has a future, and the Central Europe will have a special role and a special position in this European context. This optimism is, of course, full of criticism concerning the situation in Central Europe and concerning the relations of Central Europe with the other part of the European Union. Let's start with the with the identity of Central Europe and of Central European nations. The authors are quite strongly criticizing the still existing strong nationalism in the countries of the states of the country of the countries of Central Europe. And they just offer a very mild solution, namely to discuss the problems among each other. It reminds me to a proposal, to a suggestion of Mr. Minister of Foreign Affairs, Erlo Schwarzenberg, which he put on the table on a negotiation with János Martonyi, saying that we should discuss our problems in an unusual way. And what could be this unusual way? Let's have conferences under the title My Hero, Your Enemy. And it could lead to where? It could lead to clarification of positions concerning some heroes of our history. There are such points which cannot be resolved and is impossible to find a common denomination on it. Jelasic is a hero of Croats and will never be a hero of Hungarians. Beneš is a hero of Czechs and will never be a hero of Hungarians and will never be accepted as a great figure. As Kossuth is a hero of ours, and the Slovaks will never accept Kossuth as a great hero because they had some misfeelings with him. So that in some moments of the history, and especially some personalities, in case of some personalities, the solution is hopeless. So that we have to clarify that Beneš is important for the Czechs and he has a quite different position in our mind. And then by this, we could close down these issues and we could go on. Why is important this issue? Because the one of the most important statements and the conclusions of the book is that in Central Europe and in the identity of nations of Central Europe, the history and the culture is a basic element. And in this respect, they are absolutely different from the nations of Western Europe. In Central Europe, the history and the culture is an ally element, which is being discussed, which have a direct political impact. And in everyday political discussions, the history is present. It's not only in Hungary, it's in Slovenia, in Poland and in Slovakia and in more other countries. This is a specificity of this region, and this has to be somehow accepted by the Western members of the European Union, that it is not better or worse, it is different, and it has to be accepted. Why? Because in this, from this view, it means that the culture, which is closely related to the history, is a special and a very important element of the identity of these nations and of this region. Much more than that in Western Europe. This has to be accepted. And that's why the one of the consequences of the book is that the history and geography are two important elements which has to be taken into consideration when speaking about geography. In what sense? In historic sense. In history is used the term lieu de mémoire, the places of the memory. Those places where the people have some relations to some towns or to some regions. Now, concerning the European Union, I would like to shorten this. Concerning the European Union, there's a very interesting statement, namely that the Western European countries have an arrogant attitude toward Central Europe. Central Europe is not respected as an equal partner and an equal part of the European Union, and this should be changed. There is a suggestion how it should be changed, but first of all, why? Because the Central Europe is a key region for the future of the European Union. In what sense? The neighborhood of the European Union is, in practice, the neighborhood of Central Europe. The eastern neighborhood and the southeastern neighborhood of Central Europe is equal to the neighborhood of the European Union. For this reason, it is a strategic part of the European Union. Plus, not only the neighborhood, but the great powers have direct impact upon the future of Central Europe, Russians and Turks. They do touch the European Union through Central Europe, and even more, the Chinese. It's very interesting that how that is mentioned here, how the Chinese, China, tries to get into the European Union through Central Europe. And it is not only cultural or commercial or business problem. It is a strategic and a security issue, say the authors. The next issue is concerning the Central Europe, is the question of stability and enlargement of the European Union. Or the further enlargement of Europe, of the European Union, is closely related to Central Europe, because the further enlargement of the European Union can happen only in the neighborhood of the of Central Europe. So the enlargement and the success of Central Europe is closely bound together. Now, a few suggestions concerning the Europe's future. There is a very strong statement in the book saying that Europe's future begins in Central Europe. Europe's future begins in Central Europe. What is this? How does it begin? Central Europe, first of all, is a European success story. That is a very important statement. Central Europe and the integration is a success story. The second one is the stronger position in reforms can serve as a model for Eastern and Southeastern neighbors. The third very important statement and suggestion is the decentralization of the European Union. The suggestion is very clear. Another center should be created, another center of the European Union should be created in this part, in Central Europe. Which could be the center? For example, the second center could be Krakow. Why not? Why not include Krakow to create a second capital of the European Union? And still another very interesting suggestion, that why, for example, a Slavic language should be elevated to the level of a further official language of the European Union. This could be, I don't know, the Polish, the Slovak, the Czech. It's not mentioned, but it depends on the friendship, doesn't it? So that anyway, a Slavic language could be elevated as an official language. It's a slightly provoking but very interesting idea. Some further ideas. Yes, the tradition of the European Union is not only about technocratic, bureaucratic traditions. That the cultural traditions are as important as the business and the technocracy and as European Union institutions should respect the tradition, culture, and national identity of all member states. They cannot seek to impose any simple model of democracy. And they have to accept that Europa des der Vaterländer, Europe of homelands, or so that it has to be accepted by the rest. The next one, very strong statement, that the German-French engine is a very dangerous idea for the future of Europe. That this should be avoided. It is not the way of further integration of the European Union, because it may lead to the further separation of the Central Europe from the West. The next question, the special relation of the European Union to Russia. And in this respect, there is a sentence that Central Europe can serve as a lacmus paper for the relation with Russia. Russia and the Central European countries, it can be somehow a lacmus paper for the relation. And the last one is, perhaps this is the population of Central Europe will not support the centralizing efforts of Brussels. That is the point 11. Central population of Central Europe will not support the centralizing efforts of Brussels. So that this is, if you see, reconsider these suggestions, you can see that the whole idea And the whole book is about how to integrate Central Europe, not only in political and economic terms, but in cultural terms, and how to lift it to the level of an equal part or equal partner of European of other states, of regions of the European Union. Finally, I would like to make a few more statements concerning the book. One, there is quite a long chapter about the migration. I don't want to go into this because it's a delicate issue, and it's not for today. It can be, we could discuss it later on. The approach about Gesellschaft, it's a very interesting approach of the whole issue, how it can be perceived in theoretically. What is and the other very important element of the whole criticism concerning Central Europe is about the question of illiberal democracy. Prime Minister Orbán is criticized several times in the book concerning his statements, concerning his attitudes, Kaczynski, as well, Jaroslav Kaczynski is being criticized at some pages. But what is very interesting to the end of the Schlusspoem of the whole, that the authors at the end of the last chapter quote Viktor Orbán concerning one of his statements in a very positive way, saying that when Prime Minister Orbán said that today we feel that we are the future of Europe. And it is quoted in an absolutely positive way. It seems that the authors do agree with Prime Minister Orbán that really we are the future of Europe. Central Europe is the future of Europe. So that I can only congratulate to this book, because it's very, very, not because of this quotation, but because of the whole. This is very challenging, very fascinating, and I would suggest to make a special discussion on the book and on the issues mentioned in here. Somehow, more colleagues should read it, and then we could discuss it. And on the other, my suggestion is we should translate it into Hungarian and publish if
well, we have decided we got permission already.
We got permission, so it's excellent, and in English as well, so that it would be very useful, and we should have a discussion on details, on about the details of the book, because it's very, very interesting and very fascinating. Thank you very much.
Thank you, very, very lovely. And thought-provoking book launch. Who would like to start? Who would like to react first? The author or our challenged historian friends?
My perception was correct, or I've substance something.
No, I have to say many thanks to you, because I think you did something which is very valuable, and I learned a lot out of it. What are the main points? I think
for me,
that's quite good.
No, for
us.
For the book.
I think you are not all aware about it. We wrote it together. Emil Brix is the director of the Diplomatic Academy in Austria, and me. And you have to know, we wrote the book 3 years before the downfall of the Iron Curtain. Speaking about Project Mitteleuropa, Project Central Europe, and I think at this time we had the hope, but there was no reality behind, really. I think it was more created by a lot of artists, literarians, and so on. I think in Hungary I may quote here George Conrad, who was saying that Central Europe is a meta level of understanding here, against the situation of the division by the Iron Curtain. I think we did not predict that, we predicted that it might happen, that the Iron Curtain will down, but 3 years after, I think, this capacity of prophecy we didn't have so far. That was a reason why we wrote this book again, looking to the situation, because I think we need more trust in the common future. And so far we were defining some aims. You are rightly discussing some proposals. We even proposed a second capital for Europe, Krakow, here. That's coming out of the devotion of Emil Brix, because he was consul general in Krakow, which is very understandable, and I think it's quite good so far. And interesting enough, I may say, that gives me some hope. I think the first move of the books is sold out already, which I did not expect, and I'm very grateful to the efforts for my translation of the book, because we need for sure this discussion. I think you were focusing quite rightly on the real proposals, but also on the critical things. We were both totally aware about this, that not everything can be really understood. In one point you are totally right. I think there is really no understanding for Central Europe in the Western European parts. And this is a huge mistake.
A big point,
and
yes.
I think maybe it sounds a little bit strange, but for the moment, the famous axis between Paris and Berlin is going down. I think Mrs. Merkel might be quite soon passed, which, by all my respect for Angela Merkel, because she did a lot also for sustainability, I think I'm the first one fighting for her in this context. But also what is happening to Macron, where I was more skeptical that his proposal have a chance of realization, seen from my view, here. And I think this approach has to be changed quite quickly. So far, many thanks. I think it is a real contribution, and I'm quite happy that we can continue this discussion further on, not on the book, but on some proposals that we can move forward here.
Well, thank you for the comments. I'd like to open it because there's a great chance to talk to our distinguished speakers. Of course, with András Bán, we are also going to continue. I just want to make this remark that we decided to bring to Kőszeg part of the exhibition. He mentions a very, very interesting one. I don't have time now to talk about it, but they are using fantastic new methodologies to show interpersonal relations. Great personalities influence that time by using big data methodologies. So it's going to come to this.
I think we shall also commend Knieje Karel Schwarzenberg.
Yes.
Because one aspect I want to underline, he was mentioning history, for example, which might sound strange for some of you, but the period of the monarchy from 1850 on, this liberal part of the monarchy and so on. I think because the counterpart of illiberal is liberal, and what means liberal today, this we have to discuss, not only to criticize Orban. I'm really fed up sometimes about this.
Yeah.
I think we have to do it on the positive side, and I think here we shall jump in the ideas of Nishikara.
That we started it, a liberal friend of ours, he was an arch-liberal, a Polish political scientist, Jan Zielonka, a professor at Oxford, and he wrote an essay which is basically a coming out of a liberal political scientist criticizing liberal theory and worldview. We don't have time to repeat it, but it was very interesting. We were here with a Skype conversation, and you should read this essay. So we started this. We have to dismantle this whole construction, which is based upon air, that the politically correct liberal philosophy is going to save Europe or the world. It's not going to save anything. But on the other hand, we are in a vacuum. Maybe Central Europe will decide the future of Europe. But what if Central Europe is collapsing? Or is unable to bring up any reasonable, feasible cooperation? So please ask questions and make comments. Yes, please, and introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Dr. Rosen Dimov, and I used to work in Brussels for the EU institutions. Now I work in a consultancy company and do some research as well. I was wondering, this is mainly to the two speakers, if you could tell us what your forecast about the developments in Central Europe vis-a-vis the wider European project could be. Do you think that Europe could learn from some processes of, let's say, citizenship and transnational organization that happened in the Austro-Hungarian monarchy, although you said this is not the best title for us, or on the other hand, will there be more of relevance of the European project? It's one of the key points that was raised. It's very imbued with your do you think as a person that has been involved in the making of Europe, where is it going to from a very practical perspective, not only this 2050 strategy and something, but something that we'll see in the next few years based on your perspective?
I think so far there is quite a general answer to your questions, and I think it would be even be in the next book to think to look to the main points. I may say, from my feeling, Central Europe and even Southeastern Europe is more stable than the other parts of Europe in a certain way. I think because they have a lot of difficulties, horrible difficulties, but for the moment they are aware. They have to live with their difficulties, and it is a kind of stabilization. Maybe I'm one-sided because for a very long time I was involved, especially in Southeast Europe, here doing the Stability Pact and a lot of other efforts, and I'm still here. But on the other side, which is not so much seen, they are really in favor of Europe. Not only because they want money from Europe, everybody wants money from Europe, it's quite clear. But they are aware that they have no alternative. And I think they are outspoken in this direction, that there is no alternative. I think we have to ask our dear English friends and others who are critical, what is the alternative? I think
chaos.
What we are missing is the global approach of Europe. I think there's an Austrian politician, not my party, but this sentence I'm very much appreciating. He's always telling, we Europeans are now 7% of the global population, we will be quite soon only 4% of the global population. We are still a little bit more than 20% of the economic output, and so on and so on. And we are consuming 50% of all what is really existing, and that is not sustainable. And I think we Europeans have to be confronted with this in this context. The second answer to you was mentioned by Klüger, Karel, Schwarzenberg. I think we have to define what has to be in common in Europe. And here we are discussing, in general, the wrong questions. I think for sure a little bit we are discussing defense, but only a little bit. I was listening today to the news. I think the Germans are now discussing which advisory companies were working with the German army and so on and so on. I think there's no discussion with which role will the German army have and others, and so how this is done. But it is not only this question of security, it is cyber security and so on and so on. Security is a large field, without any doubt, sometimes overestimated, sometimes wrong directed, but for sure it's existing, and all the other things. We are not discussing what the Chinese are doing. They are jumping in the infrastructure of Europe for sure. I think I'm never understanding why the railway system from Athens to Budapest is improved by the Chinese. Where are the Europeans? I think we Europeans shall improve the railway system between Athens and Budapest. Okay. And that's not even discussed. And here you can put up a line on all the questions. I'm mentioning this because it's more understandable if we're focusing on the railway, but we have quite more in this direction, which we have to do. And I think we have to move the discussion in this direction, to the real questions of the Europeans, which for sure is not happening. And then we have one problem, which is partly mentioned in the book, but it is more general. I think we have a real problem, what means democracy today and now in Europe? I think this problem we are not really able to define and to look what's on. We will get a shock by the European elections next year. Not only it's written, everything will move to the right and so on and so on. It's not only the question, the number of participants will be quite few. Why? We are not able to explain what is a real question decided by the European elections. I think we have to define what is a question decided by the outcome of the European elections and how is it done. I think the election system is a nonsense. I do not understand why I have to vote in Austria for an Austrian party for the European Parliament. I want to vote for a European party for the European Parliament.
Don't allow it, yeah.
And not even this discussion is happening. I think here we have to push for sure the parliaments being aware of this. They are not really interested. I was participating at the celebration of 20 years of participation of European parliamentarians in the European Parliament, in the Austrian Parliament. The president of the parliament stood there and said, I think I'm quite happy that now we have the possibility to get explanations what the European Parliament is doing. For 20 years, they were against. I think, what have the European parliamentarians to do with the Austrian Parliament? I think it's nonsense. I think these directions we have to go. Just a little bit of explanation of the direction.
Yes, Professor.
Sorry, Professor Ropel, I have a very special concrete question regarding to this vertical approach to the problems. As I remember, about 10 years ago, Austria had a special institute for Middle Europe, for the policy of Middle Europe and such things. And in that time, I think, a session or something like that. It was situated somewhere in the Buda Castle, and I remember a person who worked there, and it was very useful. But as I remember, I think the Hungarian session was closed. But is it still exist in this institute or not? Or how do you think about it?
I think we built,
I just don't know.
We built it up after the downfall of the Iron Curtain. In this time, I was in charge as a minister, and I was very much supporting it. I think we have a tendency in Austria which is horrible and it's very much criticized by me, but obviously that's not enough. I think we are withdrawing from everything. It is a general tendency. I think we are going back over to ourselves. I think it is a tendency that I'm always describing this. Everybody is thinking on himself, only me, I'm thinking on myself. This is a general tendency in which we are. It's a complete nonsense. I think we have not enough presence. I was very much fighting, for example, that an Austrian school shall be in all the neighboring countries. We have only one in Prague and one in Budapest, but in Budapest it's not done by the state, it's done by an order. And a little bit supported, but it is existing. So far, I think here we are missing the real tendency. I want to say the positive side, and maybe it's connected with the event which we will have in the afternoon. I think what is really existing, where Europe is really existing, and you mentioned it rightly, I think Europe is existing by culture. And here are no borders. The borders of culture limited by the member states of the European Union is a nonsense. I think if you're listening to Tchaikovsky music, that's Europe. Yeah, they're quite okay. Yeah? No, it's Russia, they are not member, I think, and so on and so on. This is a total nonsense which is happening. I think that's the one positive side of my beloved home country or home city. Here in culture, Europe is really existing. But the consequences for politics are not really. That's one of the main difficulties for sure existing. So far, I'm extremely grateful for this exhibition. Yeah? I think we need more exhibitions.
We'll bring it here. We are going to translate it into English. Okay. Maybe German. We'll talk about it. If there aren't any further questions or comments. Yes, Aniko?
I would like to ask Prince Karel von Schwarzenberg to thank you for the excellent and very provocative contribution, and it's good to hear from all of us. How do you see this Visegrad 4? Does it make any sense? Professor Buszek already commented that no. You are sitting even closer.
To tell the truth, I was present at the founding of the Visegrad Group nearly 30 years ago. I went with my president Havel to Visegrad and when it was founded. Basically, it is a very useful thing. A cooperation of states close together, having the same past, having the same experience, and a lot of similar problems, basically is a very good thing. The problem is that in the meantime, it turned to the opposite what it was founded for. Because we founded Visegrad, and I'm a witness, I was present there, to get our nations, our states, as soon as possible into the European Union. And that we should cooperate on it, on this way to the European Union and the NATO alliance. In the meantime, to my utter astonishment, the Visegrad group turned into a group with an eternal opposition to the aims of the European Union. So it is serving exactly the opposite purpose it was founded for. So still I do think the idea of cooperation of our states is very good. Maybe we should exchange our politicians.
Okay.
There's one part, may I say, which is very relevant still. That's a cultural foundation.
Yes, it's good. Yes.
Yes, but this is very good. This is where we are going to continue next year. But the last question from our friend.
I'm from Pakistan. I just finished my master here. And thank you so much for the introduction of this book. But what I got from the book, it was like the end of the book is like more focused on the future of the, like, Central Europe as the future of the Europe. But I'm just wondering, since then, that like in what sense the future of the Europe, like the Central European as a failure for the EU in the future, or as a success for the future? Because if you look at the contemporary situation, it's going quite opposite, like in the failures, because of the contemporary situation in Poland. And in Hungary, they are going against the basic principle of the EU. So it is the role of the. So just my question is that what is the role of the Central European as a future for the EU, as a failure or as a success? Because it's more like more focused on the future of the EU. But in what sense? I don't understand this.
I think may I have one comment concerning a sentence you used. Hungary and Poland being against. They are against sometimes politically some movements, but they are taking the money. I think so far, if I'm discussing with Viktor Orban, he wants to stay. I'm a real European. And so on. I think looking to the money, it's going further on. Recently, I was at the University of Debrecen, for example, which is A huge university, B the second biggest city of Hungary, and C what is happening there. There's investment of Bosch, BMW is coming there, and all the students were very much devoted to Europe. I think the perception sometimes, in all my criticism to Orban, is one-sided. I think we have to look to all the sides here, maybe to turn in the right direction.
This is political discussion. Political rhetoric is different from reality.
That was your real question. We are convinced, we both write the book, that we have, by the geographical, by the historical, and hopefully by the political situation, the possibility to contribute to Europe through Central Europe, because neighborhood to Russia, the neighborhood of the Balkans to the eastern part of the Mediterranean Sea so far, Near East and so on is connected, and also the migration problem, which is a crucial question, also I think is very much going through this, and we have some experiences. I think my beloved government in Austria is always making a lot of comments concerning migration. The reality in Austria, I think until now we managed migration very good.
Very well.
We have no problems in this direction. And in reality, we are happy that people are coming because we need them so far. I think we need another style. There's one governmental party which is living out of being contrary against any move. It's also coming out by this UN decision, which is for sure a total nonsense. But what we are missing is a real discussion. It was the reason why we wrote the book.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. A big applause. Thank you for András and Ivan. And this was more a colloquium, a workshop. We want to continue. We continue where we finished. With culture, someone said nobody figured who, Jean Monnet or Robert Schumann, but it's a very good bon mot that if we could start again, we should start with culture. Now we are close to a kind of a political institutional. Jean Monnet or Robert Schumann. Nobody could find this quotation in de facto in any written text, but it's in the air. So I think we should start with culture, we should continue with culture. We will show you next time our slides, which was, we didn't have enough time, how influential Vienna and Budapest were on European and Central European culture, and this impact is still with us. We can build upon it, it's very rich, and let's enjoy the concert, which starts soon. This will be Schubert,
at 4:30.
Everyone is kindly invited, and we have a dinner and a party afterwards, and also everyone is invited. We can continue the discussion for dinner.
And there is coffee and something to nibble on, some refreshments.